Good afternoon. I'm Peter Bixby, Chairman of the 2021 MVAR Public Policy Committee. We're excited to present this panel discussing accessory dwellings throughout Northern Virginia. This is an issue our policy committee has been deeply involved with, and we wanted to make sure all of you, our members, are informed about the current laws and issues. We're joined today by planning and zoning staff from our Northern Virginia jurisdictions. Our planners on the panel include Carmen Bishop and Casey Judge with Fairfax County, Joel Franklin with Arlington County, and Sam Shelby with the City of Alexandria. And to moderate a panel, I'd like to introduce Andrew Clark, Vice President, Government Affairs for the Home Builders Association of Virginia. Welcome, Andrew. I'll go ahead and turn the program over to you to get things started.
Excellent. Well, thank you, Peter, and welcome to all the NVAR members and guests. And I'll apologize in advance for my allergy voice, but thankfully I won't be doing much talking today. Accessory dwelling units or accessory living units are increasingly recognized nationwide as a tool to address the growing gap in housing supply and demand and address some of the housing affordability challenges that are persistent throughout the Commonwealth. And two quick data points I found really interesting. Between 2009 and 2019, Freddie Mac estimates that the number of first-time listings of ADUs grew about 8.6% each year. And in terms of the number sold, less than 9,000 units or homes sold in 2000 had ADUs. By comparison, 2019, nearly 70,000 of those units had ADUs. So definitely a growing part of the market. And in the last 2 years, most of the major jurisdictions in Northern Virginia have expanded the ability to build and use these small living spaces in predominantly residential neighborhoods. These are your backyard granny flats, guest houses, your downstairs English basement apartments, mother-in-law suites, many names, all kind of capturing a kind of an essence of a smaller dwelling unit. And so these residential units are increasingly a part of the housing toolbox in Northern Virginia, but they are still relatively new and somewhat untapped component of the housing market. And today, we're fortunate to have several experts from jurisdictions in Northern Virginia who have really been, I think, leading the charge in Virginia, trying to figure out how to incorporate these units into our housing strategy. So with that, I'd like to invite the panelists to kind of give an overview of the current ordinances and permitting processes for these accessory units in their jurisdictions. And we'll start with Casey and Carmen in Fairfax County.
Yes, thanks. We're happy to be here today. So Fairfax County did just adopt a new zoning ordinance in the board made their adoption in March of this year, and it took effect very recently on July 1st. One of the big components of that new ordinance was our accessory living units. Fairfax does have to be a different. We had a new name to reduce the confusion between affordable dwelling units. So these ALUs, as we call them, they're a subordinate unit that has eating and cooking, sleeping, living, and sanitation, and it's in conjunction with a single family detached dwelling. The detached part is important because they're not permitted with a townhouse or a duplex. It is really only those single family detached dwellings that can have these units. So an ALU can have up to two people and two bedrooms. We do have an owner occupancy requirement in Fairfax County. So the owner of the dwelling does have to either live in the principal dwelling or the ALU itself. So administratively, we now allow accessory living units if they are interior. So that's your basement or your addition to your home. It does require a $200 application fee and then renewal after the first 2 years and then it's succeeding 5 year renewal periods. For a detached ALU, we do still have a 2 acre lot size requirement. So that is important for detached. There is a big distinction between the two. We also do require a special permit with the Board of Zoning Appeals for a detached ALU. For the interior ALUs, we do have a parking requirement. So one additional off-street parking space is going to be required. Now this can be modified with special permit approval if somebody cannot provide that space. So we have a series of other standards. The sizes differ based on interior versus detached and a couple other standards that are applicable, but that's kind of the nuts and bolts of ALUs in Fairfax County.
Do we move on to Joel maybe?
Sure, so just a little background. The original accessory dwelling ordinance in Arlington was adopted in 2008 and implemented in 2009. However, at the time, there was a large amount of community conversation and the regulations that got adopted were restrictive due to community concerns about overcrowding, large number of accessory dwelling units being added. and parking. As a result of the restrictive regulations, not many units were created, only about 20 units approved in about 8 years. So in 2015, when the county adopted the Affordable Housing Master Plan, it recommended review of the ordinance to encourage greater use. The plan really identified accessory dwellings as an existing tool to provide an adequate supply of housing, help older adults age in place, provide a typically lower priced housing alternative, and enable homeowners to receive that additional income. So starting in 2016 and through 2017, we went through a community process and revisions to the existing accessory dwelling ordinance were adopted by the board in November 2017, with the exception of new detached accessory dwellings. We did have a subsequent separate process that was undertaken in 2018 and 2019 to allow for new detached accessory dwellings. So these amendments did encourage greater use of accessory dwellings. And to date, since the 2017 and 2019 amendments, we've had 96 accessory dwellings that have been approved, of which 53 were in the main dwelling and 43 were detached accessory dwellings. I'm not gonna go over all the requirements for an accessory dwelling, but I thought I would cover some of the changes we made to really realize that increase in the number of accessory dwellings. These included removing requirements regarding lot area and width. We estimated this opened up about at least 20% more lots in the counties that could create an accessory dwelling. So accessory dwellings are now allowed on all lots with one family detached dwellings. We eliminated the size requirement for an accessory dwelling in a basement, arguing that it was still accessory to the principal use by the virtue of its location, which is in the basement. The size limit of 750 square feet still remains for an accessory dwelling that is located outside the basement. We found this was a big barrier. Someone would have to partition off part of the basement if it was over 750 square feet. We removed some design guidelines that made configuring the entrance of the accessory dwelling difficult. We increased the maximum occupancy from 2 to 3 people. We removed a requirement that the owner must live in the house for at least 1 year before getting approval of the accessory dwelling. This requirement presented challenges, if not an impossibility, for new construction of new home buyers wanting to renovate before moving in, as the accessory dwelling cannot be approved until the owner has lived in it for 1 year. Probably the biggest change was allowing for the conversion of existing detached accessory buildings, garages, et cetera, into accessory dwellings, and then allowing for construction of new detached accessory dwellings. The one difference between conversion versus new construction is that the construction of new detached accessory dwellings has a greater setback than those that are already existing and being converted. We need to be at least five feet from the rear side lot line. A couple other things that were part of the community conversation that remained unchanged, including much like Fairfax, we have an owner occupancy requirement. The county thought this was critical to ensuring that the one family dwellings are not purchased for the purpose of creating two family investment properties. And we continue to allow for short-term rentals such as Airbnb and accessory dwelling, letting the owner decide how best to use that accessory dwelling. So just quickly about the process of constructing an accessory dwelling. It's a by right process. So if you meet the requirements, you can build one. We strongly recommend applicants request a consultation meeting with the zoning division to discuss the projects early on. These meetings also include discussion with other staff, such as fire and life safety implications and environmental implications. All of these projects will require at least 2 permits, accessory dwelling permit and a building permit. And then a certificate of occupancy is also required before the tenant can occupy the accessory dwelling. Typically, this process is completed within 30 days for the building permit is completed within about 10 days. Then lastly, a declaration of covenants must be recorded on the county land records division in the building permit. This really helps with that new owner that's coming and potentially purchasing the property to know that they have an accessory dwelling on the land. Well, no further zoning amendments are being pursued right now. Some residents have petitioned the board for changes to some of the standards. These include looking at other zones such as townhomes. So currently, I've said that they're only allowed in single-family detached zones. Looking at increasing the height of a detached accessory dwelling, which is currently limited to 1.5 stories, and then increasing the footprint for a detached accessory dwelling, which is limited to 560 square feet in some smaller zones and a little bit bigger in some of our larger zone lots. So that's it, and thank you. I look forward to any questions you might have.
Excellent, thank you. How about Sam?
Yeah, so our policy is almost a year old now. You know, it was passed by City Council this year, and we had the benefit of being a little bit later to the game, not as early adopters as Arlington. So we were able to push the boundaries a little bit more with our ADU policy. So as Casey mentioned, we don't have any lot size requirements. And as Joel mentioned, we allow ADUs in any kind of dwelling except for like a multifamily or an apartment. So you can have an ADU in your townhouse or in your duplex. And our policy really does mirror both Fairfax and Arlington's. What we really wanted to do was just be really intentional that these units are smaller than the primary dwelling. So they, you know, generally the magic number in our ordinance is about 1/3 of the size of the main dwelling. You know, a detached ADU can be up to 20 feet tall. And we in Alexandria do almost everything a little bit special, but we also use floor area ratio for our all properties in the city. And so the 1/3 rule also works for our internal units. So, you know, units within a home work because of how, you know, floor area is calculated and that sort of thing. When we took this to City Council earlier this year, we tried to get away with not having an owner occupancy requirement. We, you know, in looking to other jurisdictions across the nation, with the help of our consultant, you know, we sort of came to the conclusion that, or staff came to the conclusion that the owner occupancy requirement is not necessarily a land use issue, that requiring an owner to be there doesn't necessarily guarantee that there won't be complaints by neighbors, and that, you know, there's no occupancy requirement for any other dwelling type in the city. So we just, that was something we tried to get away with. Council didn't agree with that. They received some comments from the public throughout the process, and then sort of last minute at the hearing to add that in. So for ours, it's the owner has to maintain the property as their primary residence when they're applying for the ADU permit. And we established a separate administrative ADU permit through just planning and zoning that you sort of kicks off the ADU permitting process. And for us, that's basically just to help us keep track of where these are. The other thing that council, we were, short-term rentals are allowed, you know, in Alexandria now, and we didn't want to create any special restrictions for short-term rentals for ADUs. But again, council felt differently. And so right now, short-term rentals are permitted, but only for 120 days per calendar year. The process almost identically follows what Joel mentioned. You know, you get the ADU permit from planning and zoning, then you move on to your building and your trade permits. Let's see, there was one other. We limit the occupancy to 3 people. So no more than 3 people can live in an accessory dwelling. And we also do not require any off-street parking for the accessory dwelling. And then, you know, there's a lot of sort of bulk and use or size standards depending on whether it's detached or attached and how big the lot size is and that sort of thing. We are due back to report to council. We set a certain number of permits. Right now we've only received 10 since the policy went live earlier this spring. But we're due back to City Council to kind of report on our findings and you know, explain where these have been built and you know, any issues that have sort of come up. And hopefully, in my hope to make it the policy a little simpler. It's very difficult for citizens to understand especially like the size regulations and that sort of thing. So hopefully some sort of simplification would be in order when the time comes.
Excellent. Well, that was all extremely informative. And I'm going to pose these questions. If you want to answer, feel free to pop up. If you want to take a pass, that's fine too. The first one being, and some of you kind of touched on this, you know, how instrumental or what size of accessory dwelling unit is part of your locality's affordable housing strategy? I know they're relatively recent, and it sounds like most localities are starting to put the instruments in place to track them. So I guess, you know, one, what are your jurisdictions thinking in terms of short-term viability to address housing affordability? And do you see that growing over time or kind of staying flat? And I'll just throw that out there. Feel free to jump up as you like.
Sure, I can go first. So as I mentioned, this was part of our affordable housing master plan, and it really looked at it as just another tool to help us get that adequate supply of housing. And I think the first time around, we kind of made the mistake of, you know, saying these were going to be affordable, and we can't guarantee that, right? So a lot of times this is going to be new construction, it's going to be expensive, but they tend to rent a little bit lower, just be given the size and often where they're located, maybe in a basement, no amenities. So they do tend to, we've noticed, rent for a little bit less than, say, a market, a traditional like high-rise type apartment. So like I said, it's more an additional tool in our toolbox.
So I would just say the same thing for here, that it's important to note that, well, I guess I'm used to calling them ALUs already, but it's important to note that they are not committed affordable units, but based on the research that we reviewed when we were going through the process of developing the new regulations, they do tend to rent for less. They also can be a means to helping the owner. If they, you know, have this added income, it can help the owner as well. So we think it's important to recognize that they do play a role in affordable housing. They're not the only role, but they're important. And then we are also working with our other departments, Department of Housing and Community Development and Family Services, to try to reach different populations and even to target people who may have vouchers for affordable housing to try to make that, do that matchmaking and make that connection.
Yeah, and I'll just quickly echo, you know, essentially everything that Joel and Carmen mentioned we're pursuing and have thought of, or, you know, that we came to the same conclusions on ADUs for us. The only other minor piece that I'll mention that was really important to us was that ADUs could present an opportunity for a lower income family to end up in a neighborhood with really great amenities like great schools and parks and open space in a neighborhood that, you know, otherwise a family or an individual couldn't afford. And that was one of the more real alluring, you know, benefits of this to an ADU policy for us.
Excellent. The second one, and Sam, actually all three of you probably, four probably focus on this, but Sam in particular. So anytime, you know, working for the builders, we're not unfamiliar with adjacent communities being a little bit concerned about new residential growth or development or changes in zoning. And so anytime these changes come up, whether you're changing the underlying ordinance or somebody's got an application in for to build an accessory unit, you've got a lot of folks who come out and talk about impact on schools, roads, property values, so on and so forth. I guess a question for you all is, in your experience, what are some of the most frequently cited concerns, whether it's with zoning or with an actual structure itself? And what did you guys find effective in addressing and collecting that feedback and alleviating concerns or moving past the opposition to get to a good point?
I would say one of the biggest reoccurring themes we heard during our hearings was the concern about the elimination of single family zoning. There was a big concern about accessory dwelling unit or living units now effectively creating multifamily units. And so I think it was really important for us to make sure that we really stress that these are subordinate units to have the limitations on the number of occupants as well as the size limitations. We came out originally with a larger size and we're compromising throughout the process. We also heard a lot of parking concerns, and we had originally not recommended having a parking space, an off-street parking space, but based on the community feedback, we did end up incorporating a parking space as our staff recommendation to kind of find that middle ground.
I think the biggest complaint that we, or the most common concern we heard was short-term rentals and just the fact that renters may be living in people in a person's neighborhood. And in some ways we tried to reframe the conversation because the anti-renter sentiment is not, is sort of based on anecdotal experience and not like true life experience. So we tried to remind people that, those that were concerned that renters live throughout the city, and just because somebody's renting doesn't mean that they're an inconsiderate neighbor or that sort of thing. And we sort of said the same thing about short-term rentals, is that they're already allowed everywhere in the city now. So the use of an ADU as a short-term rental with the restrictions we put in place, like Casey mentioned, the occupancy limits and the size limits, would really not result in any sort of enormous change to their neighborhoods. So that was the intention of our policy, was to create an incremental shift in housing and not transform neighborhoods overnight, that it would take 50 years or more to for these ADUs to be noticeable in neighborhoods.
Yeah, I'd agree with, we heard all those same concerns. But I think that the benefit we had was we started this, over 10 years ago and had a very restrictive ordinance, and, the sky didn't fall, we're the county's all right. So I think what we did the second time around was really engage, the building community, the advocates, the people that really wanted to see that, to help push this message forward. I think the biggest thing we heard with regard to when we're looking to implement detached accessory dwellings was actually tree impact. So we've worked with our urban forester and got some literature that can help explain, placement of that accessory dwelling where it won't impact the trees. So.
We also heard a fair number of environmental concerns. I'm not sure if flooding is as giant of an issue in Fairfax and Arlington as it is in Alexandria, but people are pretty sensitive about that right now, and climate change isn't helping. But what we did with that was remind people that with the ADU policy, we're not allowing people to build things that weren't already allowed to build. So it may not have been an ADU structure, but it could have been a shed or a garage or an addition to the home. So there's no, there's no new net square footage or cover, impervious surfaces that people would be allowed to build with an ADU that they weren't before.
And I just wanted to mention, since it sounds like Arlington and Alexandria are different than Fairfax, we do allow for short-term lodging, but not in an accessory living unit. So just wanted to make sure everyone who's listening in knows that.
Excellent. Well, thank y'all. Moving on to the next question, kind of about sort of going back to the growth over the next couple of years in ADUs. So for builders, this is helpful for builders and as well as realtors, where can our members kind of educate clients or future home buyers or property owners about your programs? Is that something that the counties are working on in terms of educating folks about what is permitted, what's not permitted? How can we help you all kind of spread the message about what your localities are really doing to pretty aggressively try to open things up to add more units to the market?
So I'm really glad that you asked this question, and I'm going to say a few things, and I hope Casey will fill in things that I leave out. But so we, of course, you know, have a planner of the day function where people can call. And occasionally we do get calls from builders and realtors. And that's really great because, you know, if we want you to call if you have any questions, because sometimes, you know, let's see, you know, we'll get a call. Somebody says, oh, well, I've got this dwelling and it's already got this accessory living unit in it. And I hear you were really revising those regulations. So is it legal? Well, most of the time it turns out it's not, you know, so that's important information, you know, to have. So we have frequently asked questions pages that we can provide and summaries of the new regulations. But really, we do want to stress that we are available to answer questions because while the new regulations, it is much more permissive in that we have removed the requirement that someone on the property be 55 years of age or older or disabled, which was the case until, well, July 1. So it's definitely opened up a lot, but there's still a lot of standards that we need to make sure that people are meeting. And the ALU permit that needs to be approved, either administratively or special permit, depending on the situation, it's granted to the applicant who is the owner. So it doesn't transfer. So you can't sell your property guaranteeing that the new owner will be able to have this accessory unit. They're going to need to apply. And I just think that's really important that people go into any kind of purchasing situation being aware of that.
Yeah, Alexandria is following a very similar approach. You know, our zoning ordinance is a complicated document in every aspect. And so we try to be as, or we are as accessible as we possibly can be. We have planner of the day type roles too. And, you know, it does get difficult sometimes working with realtors because a survey plat isn't always involved. And that's almost always needed to give any sort of definitive answer on whether or not an ADU would be permitted on a property. So it is, we can give a lot of general information that can help guide a purchase or a sale or that sort of thing. But oftentimes with the actual property owner, it's easier because they more often than not have the documents they need to show us, you know, the confines of their property.
Yeah, so Arlington continues to do outreach and education, but I think the biggest advice I can give someone is that they're thinking about this, just reach out to us. As I mentioned, we do consultations, and those are free charge. I think the better footing you're going to be on before you decide to hire an architect or start anywhere down the building, before you sink any money into this, definitely a first step should be to contact our zoning division and get that consultation scheduled.
Excellent. Well, I'll tell you from the builder's perspective, and I can probably speak for the realtors, as much as our members and realtors track everything that local government's doing every day of their lives, there are sometimes they miss something or they kind of gloss over it. And so that's great to hear you all are really kind of proactive in speaking with residents or clients and builders and things like that. That really, I can tell you, goes a long way to refreshing how people think about these things. So I've got a question.
And I can add to it, Andrew.
Go ahead.
Oh, sorry, I think we're cutting out there. Sorry, I just wanted to note too, speaking on the builder side, there are some builders who have popped up in Arlington who are now starting to specialize in constructing these accessory dwellings. So that's another good spot to start with too.
Excellent. So question from the audience, and this one is a tough one, but we'll throw it out there. The question going back to concerns from adjacent communities, specifically, how are neighbors protected from ALUs possibly causing property values to drop? I know from my limited research that I think Freddie Mac and some of these other groups have looked at kind of impacts on property values and adjacent communities, and there really wasn't really any kind of impact. But I'm curious if that's something that's jumped up on your locality's radar through public comment or internal discussions. And I'll throw that to whoever wants to take it.
I think the use limitations and the that we were talking about before, the, you know, the fact that you can't have more than three people in your unit, you know, ensures that the unit is not going to, you know, overwhelm the neighborhood. A lot of the size and setback requirements that we instituted ensure that nothing's too close to the property line that's too big or looming. And I think that's what this person is probably asking is sort of like the, you know, the use of the structure itself, because generally, you know, new construction that adds square footage to a property increases its value and increases the, you know, the comps then increase. So that's my two cents on that anyway.
During our ALU process, we did engage with our tax administration, and they indicated that neighboring assessments would not be impacted one way or the other by the addition of an accessory living unit. But yeah, I would agree with Sam, you know, when you're adding new components, like maybe a second kitchen and finishing a basement, they could have a potential positive impact on the eventual sale of the property.
Yeah, I agree with what's been said. I mean, we feel, you know, we took our time in developing these standards, and we feel that they are put in place to really limit that impact on the adjacent neighbor.
Excellent. Well, I know we're coming up on our 140 mark, but I've got one final question that's, I guess, a two-parter. Really about the future of ADUs, both in statewide policy and in local policy. And we'll start off with state first. There's been a lot of references or a few references to recent building code changes that were adopted in Virginia that add for some flexibility that address some of the, I think, code interpretation issues that popped up in some jurisdictions, which were really impediments to builders and homeowners. A builder who's advising a homeowner says we can't do it. And so I think those will be helpful. But from your perspective, part one, are there other tools, authorities, limits, or not so popular word, mandates that you all think that the General Assembly should send down to help spur some more growth in the ADU market? So we'll start with Casey, if you want to go with that one. State level first, and then we'll get to local in shortly.
Did you point at me? You broke up when I heard the name. Was it to? Oh,
yeah, I was going to say, I just wanted to get somebody who was sure. At the top of my screen.
Yes, sure. So state level wise, we actually are hoping to see maybe some of the building code change again. In Fairfax County, we had previously, we treat accessory living units as just part of one single family unit. So with the new changes to the building code, we are now going to have to require the fire rated separations or a full fire alarm system, which does include third party monitoring. So we're concerned about that. There is an added cost, not only with installing that alarm system, but also the monthly monitoring subscription. So we're actually hoping that maybe we can have some clarification at the building code level based on the new 2018 building code. But in terms of mandates, we like what we have with our new ordinance. We are monitoring and we're reporting back in 18 months. So we're collecting data to see what's working and what's not. And we hope that that can further improve the regulations while preserving our local authority.
Excellent. Well, I know we'd love to work with and we'll continue working with a lot of you on building code changes. And tell you from a builder perspective, the rubber hits the road, whether it's on affordable units, accessory units, or single family or apartments, building codes make a huge, huge difference. Joel, Sam, Carmen, anything to add on the state level side?
Oh, can you hear me? I'm sorry, I was having some connection issues there.
Yep, we can hear you.
Okay. So I think the building code one was a major kind of push for Arlington to get changed. And I think that, as you mentioned, was a very cost consideration and probably a reason we weren't seeing a lot of, especially the interior ones getting built. Likewise, we are planning to do a survey now that we have a fair number of these, you know, to see what are the kind of outstanding issues and what were the kind of the barriers in getting these done, as well as, you know, why didn't people go through with the process? Well, we know that there's a fair number of people that came in for consultation, started it, and then finished it. So, you know, what are those issues? So I think it's kind of continues to be a work in progress for us.
Yeah, and I think the city of Alexandria's policy is a little bit too new to really know what to hope for from the state level at this point. I mean, Casey brought up a good point about the expense of a fire monitoring service, but it's just too early for us to have reached any conclusions of whether or not that expense is deterring people from building ADUs, or if it's all that necessary to make sure people are safe in these units and that sort of thing. So there's just sort of like a lot of unanswered questions for us to even know really what to hope for from the state yet.
Excellent. And so part two, moving to the local, which I know you all kind of live daily. Like I mentioned earlier, the localities in Northern Virginia are really, I think this is relatively new across the country. And in Northern Virginia, or in Virginia, you all are kind of leading the edge. And I think other localities will look, I know they're looking at this. We get calls and emails saying, what can we do to facilitate X, Y, and Z? And we really, quite frankly, send them up to Northern Virginia and say they're doing a lot, whether it's with parking and setbacks and all those things. So you're really kind of setting a template. So moving from state to local, what, if anything, are you all considering in terms of expanding the ordinance or revising the ordinance? Or is it kind of wait and see and adjust accordingly? And just what's the horizon have for accessory units in your localities?
So for Fairfax, like Casey said, we are in a monitoring phase. So the new regulations, they just took effect on July 1st, and we have seen some additional units. I would say our previous regulations, they went into effect in 1983. So between 1983 and, you know, 2021, mid-2021, we only had around 200 accessory dwelling units in all that time. But there were reasons for that. The standards were very restrictive. And now since then, I think we've had maybe 30 or so, plus maybe 10 more in the wings that have submitted applications and have been approved or in the process. We think that some of that was just kind of pent up people waiting for the new regulations to come online. So we do just envision some kind of a moderate increase over what we had before, but we are hoping to see that. And we are doing surveys with everyone who gets an approval. And of course, we're keeping track of violations and so forth. And we'll be going back to the board in, you know, that 18 months from this past July, to report on how well is it working and do we see the need for any additional changes. So it'll be an interesting time.
Yeah, we're Alexandria is basically following that same sort of protocol that we're in the monitoring phase. We're due to report back to City Council in the near future. And I guess the only thing I would add is that I would hope that some of the policy compromises we made, we'll have evidence at that point and demonstrate that those changes were not necessary and that they could be removed. You know, I don't know yet at that point how council will feel about that or what the evidence will actually show, but that's kind of our hope. And the reason for that being is that, sorry, Joel, just real quick, the reason for that being that there's so many natural constraints for ADU construction, the cost particularly being like the largest one, that, you know, the research done by our consultant and by the city shows that, you know, it's the fewer policy barriers that aren't necessary for safety and for preserving neighborhood character, the better.
Yeah, similar with Arlington, still monitoring, you know, we just passed our most recent update. But I can tell you a couple of things, you know, that really came out. And I think is one of the things that Alexandria struggled with and Sam mentioned was the owner occupancy requirement. And there's a lot of advocates out there that push that think this would really increase our numbers. Especially, you know, when you have a lot of population in Arlington and Alexandria that have state department jobs that need to you know, leave their home and that type of thing. The other one we heard a lot about was increasing the size restriction, you know, 750 square feet. They feel it should be a little bit bigger than that. And we've kind of pushed back on that for now, you know, saying that these are supposed to be subordinate to the main dwelling. So those are probably some of the things we'll probably look at.
Excellent. Well, it kind of goes without saying, having worked with localities before on land use issues, this is something I think the more communication with builders and developers, and I know y'all are doing this, the better. Builders are creatures of habit. Once they grab onto something, they will repeat. And so all this has been really informative for me, who's, you know, living in the state world. It's just great hearing, I think, how you all are figuring this out and dicing it up and moving forward. So that's really exciting stuff. So any last thoughts, unless Josh needs to give me the hook before anybody wants to leave closing thoughts? Josh, we'll just keep going, man. I mean, you can't stop us, I don't think. So I'll let anybody do closing remarks if they want to. All right.
All right. Awesome. Well, yeah. Thank you all for joining us today. And thank you to our attendees for tuning in and learning about accessory dwellings. We hope you found this session insightful. Up next on the stage, we have the gory details, a legal update you need to know now with NVH Settlement Group. Please enjoy the rest of your NVAR virtual convention. Bye for now.